Thank you. crumble. I hear the chains hit the ground. Oh God of revive, pour it out, pour it out. Come awaken your people. Come awaken the city. Oh God of revive, pour it out, pour it out. Every stronghold will crumble. I hear the chains hit the ground. Oh God of revive.
My name is Neil. Welcome to Trademark Church. This is Columbus, Ohio. It's beautiful out here today. Super cool. In all seriousness, legitimately, I've already done this message twice, but we had an entire exercise group over here. They were screaming at each other the entire time. I'm like, they don't want that. And then right next to me, the second time, there was a couple over here doing their engagement photos, and the lady was like, that's good, that's good. Now turn. Good. Now look away. So I don't think you guys wanted to hear any of that, so I thought I'd do this one again. How about that? We're mobile. Our church is really, really mobile, and I'm glad that you guys are here. Some pretty big stuff, some cool stuff happened this past week. I want to tell you about it. On Tuesday, just this previous week, a bunch of ecologists at Yale, they announced something pretty wild. You're like, ecologists? I didn't even know it was a thing. It's called the Map of Life. And what they did is they worked with Google Maps, actually, and they created this interactive map. It's really cool. Basically, what it is, it's a heat map of all existing animal life on planet Earth. So you're like, what's a heat map? It's like a hot plate. It's like you make flapjacks on it. It's not. Heat map just like shows up on the map where different things are. And what they've done is they've tracked where over 32,000 different species of birds, reptiles, mammals, and amphibians live, like where they are. And then they took it a step further. This is where it gets really cool. They started documenting the likeliest spots for unknown species to still exist, like right here on Earth. What they did is they did it in hopes that these animals could be found and then maybe we could help rescue them. Does that sound like we as humans were just flexing? Like, you know, we're just like, hey, human beings here, we just created Find My iPhone for all animals on Earth. Like, don't get me wrong, I think it's actually really, really cool. It could also be rooted in this feeling like we as people, especially in 2021, that the feeling of being in control. You're like, oh no, you're stepping on toes. Yeah, because we're going to talk today about how to live through like uncertainty and unpredictability, because we here in the U.S., especially in Western culture mindset, we have gotten used to a feeling of control. Like, we plan for the future. We like love forward progress. We love momentum year after year. I'm the guy that goes up to construction sites and yells out the window like, hey, what are you building here? It's a steak and shake? Okay, good. I love progress. We love it. But the reality is, though, that control is really an illusion. But man, we love the feeling of control. We love it. We're kind of addicted to it. Now, when we feel like we're in control, we don't have to live by faith. It's just the reality of it. Control, or maybe the sense of it. It went out the window on March 14th. When did the pandemic start? March 13th, March 14th. You probably remember exactly where you were when you got a call. You're like, oh my gosh, they're shutting it down. We were on a trip to Ohio. Gene and I were traveling from Arkansas to Ohio about twice a month driving, and we would stack up all the coffees and appointments we could possibly get. But on that trip, on that day, all the appointments that I had, they started canceling one after another after another. Think about how much our world has changed in the last 12 months. Like, none of these words that I'm about to say were in our vocabulary. It was words like asymptomatic, antibodies. When's the last time you used the word antibodies? I don't even know what antibodies are. It's like Ant-Man and the Wasp. What is that? I don't even know what that means. Double vaccinations, super spreaders, Zoom fatigue, flattening the curve, cancel culture, mask mandate, none of that. We didn't know any of that. None of this was around before last year. And the best news that I can tell you is that you get a free Krispy Kreme donut for an entire year if you got your vaccination card. All you have to do is go up to the window, show them your card. You're like, that's the best news I can give you? Apparently, yes. Now, also apparently, America doesn't run on Dunkin'. Hashtag not sponsored, for sure, definitely not sponsored. When fear and uncertainty hits our life, we all reach out for some sense of direction. We try and get our bearings, you know? Like, where are the walls? Where's this? What are my bearings? I'm trying to get a feel for everything. Did you know that as humans, if we are blindfolded, that we cannot walk in a straight line? This is true, I'm not making this up. Since about the 1920s, they've been doing tests on this. Scientists have been trying to figure out why. Like, if I put a blindfold on you and stood you right here and said, walk in a straight line, you wouldn't be able to do it. What you do is, if you blindfold somebody, they start this curve to the right. It's like a corkscrew. It just keeps going right and right and in circles. And it turns into this spiral. almost every single time. Now, I'll explain why. This is way out of my element, but the Journal of Experimental Brain Research, they say the reason is the brain's vestibular and proprioceptive systems, they combine to work together. What that really means is, you're like, Neil, English. What that means is that we have to have something to aim at. If we don't have something on the horizon, or a marker, or a building, or a tree, or something, we lose track, we wander off course. I think it's an understatement that we love to know what's out ahead of us, what to expect. I'll be honest with you guys, like just gut level honest for a minute. This past year has been really, really frustrating to not be able to meet in person. We've done small groups and watch parties and all those things are incredible, but I just want to get everybody together. And the real reason it's frustrating to me is because it's out of my control. It's way beyond my control. I don't get to make the decision on it, and it drives me nuts. Psychologists will tell you that the average American has 15% control over their lives versus the 100% of control that we think we really have. Like 15%, 100%. That's a stark difference. We love to think that we're in control. And if you aren't where you thought you would be in life, you feel like you are wandering, you are searching for answers, and you're looking for God in this past year, could it be that the journey is more important than the destination? So we fixate on where we're headed, but a lot of times we forget that God actually wants to do something on the way there. Who God is creating us to be is way more important than where you are at right now. He's gonna get you there. The Holy Spirit is working on that. In the Old Testament, there's this group of people, it's the nation of Israel. Let's set up this section of scripture really quick, because the nation of Israel, they had been in slavery in Egypt for hundreds of years, and they're out, they're free. God has set them free, and they're headed toward this part of the country that God has for them. It's a section of land, it's called the Promised Land. And they are headed that way, they're finally free, but they don't end up taking the path that they thought. That sounds familiar. Anybody else feel like where you're at right now isn't where you thought you would be in life? That's me. So here it is, it's in Exodus chapter 13, is verse 17 through 18. It says, when Pharaoh let the people go, God did not lead them on the road through the Philistine country, though that was shorter. For God said if they face war, they might change their minds and return to Egypt. So God led the people around by the desert road toward the Red Sea. And the Israelites went up out of Egypt ready for battle. So like if you're looking at it on a map, God was taking them the southeast along the Suez Canal, where we know the Suez Canal is. Actually this past week, yesterday, there's a ship, massive like cargo ships in the Suez Canal. It's like a highway for ships, and it got stuck like sideways. It was like trying to do an Austin Powers in the middle of it, and it got stuck sideways and totally botched everything. Anyways, they're in the desert and they're headed toward Mount Sinai. Now why did God do this? Like what why? It's because they weren't ready to reach their destination. They thought they were. They're like, we're ready for this, we got this. But God was like, no, you're not. You're not ready. And the trip to the land of Canaan, it's Canaan, is where they were headed. That's the land that God promised them. It should have taken, and most Bible scholars, historians, they believe this is true. If you look at a map, it should have taken them 11 days. Ended up being 40 years. 11 days, 40 years. Here's the main point. Please listen to what God did for them on this trip. Exodus 13, verse 20 through 22, it says, they camped on Etham out on the edge of the desert. By day, the Lord went ahead of them in a pillar of cloud to guide them on their way. And by night, a pillar of fire to give them light so that they could travel by day or night. Neither the pillar of cloud by day nor the pillar of fire by night left its place in front of the people. You see what God gives Israel? He doesn't give them a map, he doesn't give them a schedule, doesn't give them a plan, no. Instead, he gives them his presence as a guide. Now last week, remember, Pastor Marcus, he talked about the Holy Spirit. He's our guide, he's our comforter, he's our counselor, he is our guide. Now remember that when the year is unpredictable, when your job is unpredictable, your relationships are unpredictable, God is a guide. He doesn't hand out step-by-step directions and a schedule and leave us. No, he is with his people. He's out in front. He's a step ahead and he's saying, hey, follow me. Now, the nation of Israel, they didn't really handle God's guidance well. None of it. They weren't grateful. They grumbled, they complained again and again and over and over and over again. And the uncertainty and the unpredictability was too much for them to handle. And they had a lot of reasons to complain. Don't get me wrong. They were in the desert, for crying out loud. And we do too. Not just the virus, but the economy and politics and racism and violence. It's like we're in this involuntary desert of our own right now. And it's dangerous, this crossing from, we're standing on one side and we're trying to get over here where we want to be. And God, what he does is he commands this nation of Israel to do a couple things. I want to learn really quickly from what he commanded them, because it's the same for us. First, he said, I want you to camp around my presence. He said, just trust me to lead you and to guide you. What this means is ground ourselves in God and in his peace. It also means just trust him. Let God rest in you. Be close to his presence. We can do this a lot of different ways. The simplest ways, I've been telling you guys this for months, is through prayer and reading scripture. This is right here. God literally talking to us, giving us guidance, reassuring us. Now, we can choose to let the news be our guide. Pick any news channel you want. Is that our guide? Or a political party can guide us, or our anxious thoughts can guide us, or we can choose to let the Holy Spirit be our guide. Another thing that God commanded them, and he also commands us, he said, listen, just let me form you into a people who are ready for whatever is next. Please get this. If we could simply open up our hearts and our gut and just, God, here's my soul, heal it. Holy Spirit, heal it. We want to be in cooperation with God. We don't want to stiff arm the Lord and say no. We need to be people who are okay with change and let God in our heart and in our thoughts, no matter what he asks of us. And then the last thing is really simple. He wants us to live gratefully. Like, God provided food for this nation of Israel. Basically, here's what happened. It was bread. It was called manna. Every day there would be dew that hit, like dew, D-E-W, that would hit all over the ground. And he would have them go out and they would scoop it all up and it would make this bread, and it was food for them. He provided food for an entire nation. They would get up to, like, literally, like, think about it. It's like, what would it be like to wake up to fresh baked bread every day? That'd be incredible. He provided for their needs, and in response, he said, listen, I just want you to be grateful. What did they do? Oh, they did. They grumbled, they complained, they got tired of the menu on the trip. We'll have that same temptation. It's easy to be negative. It's so easy. Instead, I would ask you to see what's possible in every scenario. It's something I pray for my own family. I'm praying it for you. God, let us be people who can see what's possible. Because there's a certain level of uncertainty that we all have to wrestle with. We like to plan things out, and it's not how it goes. Like, if you're in business, or you've ever been on a construction site or a big project, you know what a Gantt chart is? Some of you, like, just started twitching. You're like, I thought I left work behind. It's project management, project planning. And the reality is, we aren't in control of all of it. God is. That false sense of control that we have had for so long, if we're wise, what we'll do is we'll loosen up our grip on it. We'll say, no, hang on a second, God. I'm going to live this way. I'm not going to hold on tightly onto what we can't control. I want to hold on loosely to God that you're in control. Do you know there's a big difference between reacting and responding? They're two very different things. Reacting is fast. It's sharp. It's harsh, sometimes a little spicy. It's not always our best. But responding is in faith. It's with hope and loving people along the way. And the difference is knowing that God is with us through any desert, any dry part of your life, any valley that you're going through, and that's okay. Our job is to get ourselves ready for what he's trying to teach us in the middle of it. And the truth is, all of us, our security has been rooted in a lot of different things. I've put my security in a lot of things that I can see. God wants us to have our root structure connected to Jesus, not worried about what's going to happen, not how long is this going to take, why did this happen? Because being a Christ follower, it isn't a formula for being happy. It's not a self-help book, and hey, if you do these three steps, then this will happen, hashtag blessed life. Like, that's not how it works. Being a Christ follower is all about relationship with the one who rescued us. His name is Jesus, and a lot of the Bible, like even the book of Psalms, like if you open up Psalms, you start reading it, you're like, what does this even mean? It's a lot of it is lament, which is a word we don't say all that often, but if you were to do like a word cloud of all of the book of Psalm together, it would sound like this. It's like, God, things seem crazy out there right now. I don't know what you're up to. I really wish you would hurry this thing up so we can get back to normal, whatever that means, but I trust you. Almost all of Psalms is that. It's like a little bit of a complaining session followed by, God, I think this is how I want it to go, but at the end of the day, God, I trust you. And if we can live this way, holding on loosely to our plans, giving control to God, and making peace of the uncertainty that we have in 2021, we can live in the middle of chaos and be at total peace. So what's happened this past year is a lot of us, we thought that we're following Jesus. We're like, yeah, I'm a Christ follower. Harsh reality, and this is going to sound tough, is what we really have done is we've asked Jesus to follow us. Like, God, hey, I'm headed over here. Will you go with me? You might be thinking, Neil, that's a lot to ask for, like just to give up control. Yeah, it seems that way, but doing what God asks us gets easier the more obedient that we are. This is where Joshua got it right. So Joshua, same group of people, the nation of Israel, he'd been there for 40 years and they're finally getting to go into this promised land. It's in Joshua 3, verse 5. Let me get it here. It's in verse 5. Joshua and this entire nation are standing on the banks of the Jordan and he has this moment because they're about ready to finally get where they're supposed to go. They're about to cross over into the promised land, the land that God has said is yours. Here's what Joshua said. Joshua told the people, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do amazing things among you. Think about that. Like before he set foot across that river, wherever we get off track, well, actually, whenever I get off track, what I tend to do is I try and do God's job for him. And that seems noble, but we get it backwards. God wants to do amazing things among us. Our job, our role in all of it is consecration. Now, consecration is like, it's a big word. It doesn't mean like, hey, read your 1 year Bible without missing a day and keep the Ten Commandments and all this other stuff. Tell a bunch of people about Jesus. Those are all really incredible things. They're good, but they're not consecration. Consecration means full devotion. It means that we're not in control and Jesus is. It's not just doing, it's completely surrendering. And it's one of the hardest things for us to do. So my challenge to you is this, in the face of a very unpredictable year, can we set up camp just like the nation of Israel did in the presence of God? Can we try and get as close as possible to his presence and let the Holy Spirit be our guide? So he'll never fail us. He'll never leave us. He'll never steer us the wrong way. He's perfect and God has plans for you. He wants to guide you through unpredictable times and uncertain situations. Let me pray for you. God, please help us with the full devotion part of the Bible. Because we want you to be in control. We want to completely surrender. It's just hard sometimes, Lord. So please guide us with your presence. We want to be in step with you. Forgive us of our sins and give us a brand new start. Lord, in your presence every day is day one. We love you, Lord, and we trust you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I'm glad you guys are here. We're going to end this a little bit differently this week. We did worship up at the beginning of it, and that was New Life Church. That's where we came from. I love the song With Everything. It is, you guys know, if you know me, you know With Everything is hands down the single greatest worship song that has ever been recorded. Whatever, I'm partial. We're going to end a little bit different. See, when Gina and I were praying about coming to Columbus, this is about a year and a half, 2 years ago, we got to the point where we had to create a video. We did a lot of scouting. We started our church through the Association of Related Churches. And the ARC, they asked us, like, hey, do some research on the city. And so we made a video for them, and we've never shown it to you before. And what it is it's just a little bit of Columbus. And we're gonna show it today. I want you to remember how great this place, how great this city really is. Because the past year or so, it hasn't looked like the Columbus that we love. It looks very different. So here it is, and I want you to get, please understand something. It has music on it that we don't own. We made it for another group of people and never thought we'd be airing it. And there's a good chance that Facebook is gonna shut us down at the second we hit play on this. It might throw us in social media jail. We might go to YouTube jail. I don't really know. But if the feed goes dead here in a few seconds, you'll know that it didn't work. But we want you to remember this city the way that God has intended it to be, full of life, full of vibrance, people everywhere, and God doing incredible things. We love you guys. We love this city. And we're praying for you.